thanks everybody for attending this afternoon's lecture. This is the annual Pardee Center Distinguished Lecture. For those of you I haven't met yet, my name is Tony Janatus. I'm the director of the Pardee Center. The center was established here at Boston University really in order to catalyze research across the entire university on understanding the forces that essentially caused the world to unfold the way it does, whether they're environmental, scientific, political, economic, or cultural. The center seeks to catalyze research to understand the way these different forces interact. Each year, we have a distinguished lecturer, and I have to tell you that this is one of the most entertaining and really just kind of fun parts of my job, is trying to select out of all the people whom we could possibly invite, who would give the most rounded perspective, cogent insights into a whole variety of issues affecting sustainable development and affecting environmental issues in the advancement of the human condition. So this afternoon, I am especially pleased to introduce Sir Robert Watson. And I've known Bob since sometime in the 20th century. In a variety of under a variety of circumstances, from when he started his career as a program manager and manager of science in NASA. Bob had come out of a laboratory-based program on atmospheric chemistry, spectroscopy, if I remember correctly, and soon found a really important niche in the space program, but what happened when he did was that he became involved in one of the early global environmental issues that has, in a sense, been successfully attacked, at least at a policy level, and that was the Montreal Protocol and the problem of stratospheric ozone depletion. Bob quickly moved on to play leading roles in the formation of the U.S.'s scientific approach to global change issues, and chaired both the Working Group 2 of IPCC, the Working Group on Impacts, Adaptation, and Vulnerability, and ultimately chaired the entire Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. Not being content with only addressing climate issues, Bob has also chaired scientific assessments such as the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment, the first global assessment of the status of ecosystem services, the Global Biodiversity Assessment, a really interesting food security assessment for the World Bank, and he moved from NASA to the Office of Science and Technology Policy to the World Bank, and then to posts in the UK. Bob was I have to read this because I'll never remember it. He's not only a fellow of the Royal Society, but he was recognized as a Knight's Bachelor in 2012 and a Companion of the Order of St. Michael and St. George before that in 2003. So it's really, it's my pleasure and my privilege to introduce Bob. He is currently the chair of the Intergovernmental Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services. I knew I could remember what that was. He's going to share his thoughts on this interface between policy and science in a lecture entitled Evidence-Based Policy or Policy-Based Evidence. Following Bob's talk, we'll engage in conversation, open up to Q&A, and then following all of that, we have a short reception for everybody out in the foyer. So with that, Bob.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here. And after that introduction, the talk will definitely be an anti-climax. Yeah, what I want to try and do today is really talk about the science policy interface, and in particular the role of international assessments. As you just heard from Tony, I currently do chair IPBES, and I have been involved in agricultural ozone climate assessments and biodiversity assessments in the past. So first I want to give a general description of what I see as part of the science policy interface, then talk about three particular issues: stratospheric ozone depletion, climate change, and then biodiversity, and then just one page of conclusions at the end. So what do I see as key issues? First, unless we've got really strong science programs at both the national and international level, we will not have what we need, which is good science, which is absolutely essential for informed public policy. However, what we have to recognize is, while it's important and essential to have good science, it's not sufficient for decision making. A minister in any government of the world or a senior person in business has many other factors to take into consideration other than just some of the scientific and economic information. I learned that very much working both in the White House and then as a science advisor in the UK government, that a government minister really has many, many issues to put into place on whether it's climate change, biodiversity. Do you cull badgers to stop bovine tuberculosis? Do you actually ban neonicotinoids, a pesticide that is now blamed in many places for killing honeybees and wild bees? And so we have to recognize we need good science. I would argue we're still underfunding social sciences, and research in most developing countries is completely underfunded. And if we're dealing with a global issue, whether it's climate change, loss of biodiversity, we need science to be strong throughout the world. Why should a minister in an African country listen to me? They really should be listening to their own scientific community. And clearly, multi and interdisciplinary science, absolutely critical. I think the new Future Earth programme, which is transdisciplinary, I was the chair of the engagement committee for a short period of time. It builds on previous programs like the World Climate Research Program, International Geosphere Program, Diversitas. I really think that has the potential, but time will tell to see if it really works. Truly has the potential for being a really excellent transdisciplinary research program where the program is co-designed with the end users and some of the research is co-produced. It'd be really nice if we had much more public-private funding where they work together with strong peer review. I think issues like genetic modification, issues such as neonicotinoids, they're either funded only by the private sector or only by government, and it really does cause an impasse in debating many of these key issues, basically. Obviously, I do strongly believe that national and international scientific assessments are crucial to the science policy interface, and I'll spend most of my talk on it. What we're finding more and more, especially when you go to issues of agriculture, issues of biodiversity, we really need to think through how do you integrate modern, I'll call it Western science, with indigenous and local knowledge. And it really is becoming a struggle, which we try to approach on both the agricultural assessment, I would say with very limited success, and now in IPBES we're trying again to both get knowledge holders, people who do live in indigenous groups, the knowledge holders and experts in ILK, to bring their knowledge along with that of Western science. Clearly, communication is absolutely vital. So what is an assessment? I think the top bold says it all. It's a critical evaluation. It's not a review of knowledge. It's a critical evaluation of information to help guide, not to form, but to guide decision-making on complex public issues. Therefore, you do need co-design, in my opinion now, of the scope of an assessment, not just the scientific community, but the end user. They clearly have to be prepared by the best experts in the world, clearly got to be peer-reviewed, and we really do need the full range of scientists, from natural scientists, social scientists, the humanities, law, etc. All need to play a role, and if it's an international assessment, we need good geographic balance. There's no way that an African minister is going to believe a report only written by US scientists or European scientists, basically. Assessment should be policy relevant, not policy prescriptive. This is highly debated by some people. Many people believe scientific community should tell governments what to do. I strongly disagree with that. I do believe they'd be extremely policy relevant, and there's still a way of getting a message across to policymakers without being prescriptive, such as if you want to limit global warming to 2 degrees Celsius, you do need to eliminate emissions of all greenhouse gases by the middle to the end of this century. If you want to get rid of the Antarctic ozone hole, you have to get rid of all chlorine and bromine containing gases that enter the stratosphere. So, you know, that is an if then. If you want to achieve the following, then these are the sort of options. And so that way you're not being policy prescriptive, but you are being highly policy relevant. And clearly an assessment must, for a policymaker, reduce complexity, mainly by synthesis. One of the basic problems is for us as scientists is to understand the needs of society and decision makers. What do they want assessed? What knowledge base is actually important to them? Do we understand as scientists the socio-political system? Do we actually get disillusioned by the political reality of how decisions are made, the political context of decision making? But unless we actually work with decision makers and understand the complexity of the policy making process, the political realities of a minister in the US government, the UK government, or a government in Africa, our work actually falls on deaf ears. So we really do have to understand how decisions are formulated and made. Equally, the policymaker needs to understand the scientific community and what we can bring to the party as well. As I said, assessments need to be conducted in an open, transparent way, otherwise they're not credible. You need well-defined principles and procedures. Sounds awfully boring, but if you don't know how you're going to select the authors, how you're going to select the scope, how you're going to peer review or approve the document at the end of the day, if we don't have all these boring things well understood, no one's going to trust the process, and therefore no one will trust the end product. So we need ownership throughout the whole political process and scientific process of developing an assessment. And we need all of the relevant stakeholders, from governments, NGOs, private sector, etc. And what governments want is they want to know a consensus view of what is known, what is uncertain, and what is unknown. Where we often fail, in my opinion, is I'm not sure we adequately explain the implications of uncertainty for policy formulation. We do a good job now of actually quantifying what we know, how much we know, what the uncertainties are, but I'm not sure we often go the extra mile of saying what are the implications for policy formulation at a national or an international level. It's the one area that I think we still could indeed probably do a better job. It's very obvious the more governments you have in these intergovernmental processes, the more they have legitimacy and ownership. Clearly, when you have governing bodies of an assessment, if they're international, you need their bodies, such as their bureaus or scientific advisory bodies, to be geographically balanced, otherwise they lose credibility. Assessment should indeed be multi-thematic, multi-spatial, multi-temporal. We need all of these. Looking at plausible futures, absolutely a critical element in everything we do now, basically. Real challenge when you work on issues such as GMOs, trade, and agrochemicals, to knock out the ideological views from that are based on good evidence. And when I directed the agricultural assessment, those three issues, it was really hard to try and stop people bringing their ideology to the table, right, and really focus on the hard scientific evidence, basically. Showing different views, absolutely critical, basically. One of the most critical elements of any assessment, many of these are 1,000 pages, 1,500 pages long. They're all getting way too long. The last IPCC reports were way too long, in my opinion. But the crucial issue is, how do you take those assessments that can be 1,000 pages, they talk to the other expert, and how do you make them understandable to a decision maker in government, a decision maker in a private sector? And therefore, they are, in my opinion, the most critical elements of an assessment. Therefore, they must be written in a less technical language, but still being totally technically correct. Key issue is to make sure we are addressing the most policy-relevant issues in the assessment, not just the issues that are most scientifically interesting. Clearly, the chairs need to work with the chapter lead authors, must be heavily peer-reviewed, because one of the key issues on in a synthesis document is, have you selected the right issues to summarise in these documents, and have you got the nuances right? When you bring a 1,000-page document down to 10 to 20 to 30 pages, you've got to be very careful not to lose the key nuances in the sentence. Very easy for the sentences or the paragraphs to be either stronger or weaker than the main background document. So the scope's crucial, and the tone of the document is absolutely crucial. And whilst many scientists argue against it, I believe governments approving these documents line by line is absolutely critical for ownership. So some of the challenges, very straightforward, funding for experts, both to participate in the assessment, but also to do independent data analysis and modelling, especially the modelling. There just isn't enough money, in my opinion, at the moment, to do modelling specific for some of these assessment processes, basically. Clearly got to enhance the science capacity in developing countries. Clearly got to get far more social scientists and the humanities interested in these big assessment processes. A real challenge, as I've already said, of bringing indigenous and local knowledge, which is absolutely crucial when you look at certain issues like biodiversity. Also, it's crucial to bring in the private sector, but highly controversial. We've just finished the pollination assessment, and out of the 83 authors, for it's a fairly focused document, pollination in agricultural systems. It wasn't all of pollination. We had two authors that worked for the private sector. The NGO community went berserk and criticised us for having anybody from the private sector, arguing the fact you've got two authors from the private sector, one was from Syngenta, one from Bayer, will totally distort the findings. Absolutely ridiculous. We need the perspectives of experts, whether they're in government, academia, NGOs, or the private sector. But boy, it's become a real hot button issue of should you have experts from the private sector involved? My answer is absolutely yes. I think in the ozone assessments, we had a couple of experts who did work, a person such as Mac McFarlane, who worked for DuPont. Absolutely crucial that he was actually involved. He could go back to his bosses in DuPont and say, these assessments are valid, they've undergone good due process, and boy, in this instance, they show that our chemicals, DuPont, are helping to destroy the ozone layer. So I very strongly believe the private sector must be involved. But the experts must be involved in their individual capacity, not representing that private sector or not representing a government. I think one of the interesting challenges now for the academic community is how do we understand the interlinkages between some of the environmental issues like climate change, loss of biodiversity, degradation of ecosystem services, and all of the other sustainable development goals. What are the implications of a loss of biodiversity on poverty, on hunger, on water purity, on gender, etc.? And in fact, in the IPBS, we're just starting now a global assessment of biodiversity and ecosystems. And one of the thrusts will be to understand the links between biodiversity and ecosystems for every one of the first 16 goals, which are all thematic. So we're trying to show that biodiversity is not just a fuzzy green thing that you want to go and hug a tree or protect a certain species. It is absolutely central to sustainable development. And so the three issues I'll quickly talk about are stratospheric ozone depletion, climate change, and biodiversity. On stratospheric ozone, there is, as many of you know, a convention. There was the Montreal Protocol with its amendments and adjustments, and it had a really strong scientific process, which actually looked at the science of the ozone layer. It looked at some of the impacts, such as the effects of more ultraviolet radiation on skin cancer, and it looked at the technical and economic issues associated with the substitutes. Climate change, we have a convention, we have the Kyoto Protocol, and now we have the Paris Agreement that was agreed late last year, where 196 countries at least have claimed they sign up to the Paris Agreement. I'll talk about that a little bit later. Very strongly supported by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, which is the primary advisory body on the scientific issues, the impact issues, and on mitigation, and on the economics of both adaptation and mitigation. And then we have the Biodiversity Convention and the convention, there's another convention that's also equally relevant, the one on desertification. And until recently, they were just ad hoc assessment processes. Now with the IPBS, we now have in place a well-formulated assessment process to also provide relevant information for decision-making. So on stratospheric ozone, I've really already said this, basically, we do have a good assessment process. My view is it was highly influential, and it still is highly influential, science is highly influential on both national, international policy formulation and implementation. Basically, all medium and long-lived chlorine and bromine chemicals that deplete stratospheric ozone have been banned globally. I would put this as the success story. This just actually is it was actually done by Dan Albritton, and that's why much of it is in hand. And what we found over time was the original Montreal Protocol was really based largely on theoretical studies showing that if you had chlorine and bromine species, they entered the stratosphere, long-lived, they would destroy ozone. But there was not proven ozone depletion at that time, especially attributable to human activities. So in red down the right-hand side, you see a whole series of new science. We discovered the ozone layer, and it was explained. And several of the key players are in the audience today and know much more about this than me. Then we found some observed ozone trends and looked to see the consistency with theoretical models. We observed ultraviolet radiation at the Earth's surface. Was it consistent with theory? And then basically started to observe these ozone depleting gases were starting to decline in response to the Montreal Protocol, the London Amendments, etc. But the key link was from scientific discovery, a whole series, literally about every 4 years, of scientific assessments on the science, on the impacts, and on technology. And it really went from science to assessment to a whole series of London Amendments, Copenhagen Amendments, etc. As I say, I doubt if we'll ever see anything quite so structured again on a major international environmental issue. This just shows it now comes all the way up to 2014. They've actually, since that slide was put together, been a couple of more changes in policy. And as you can see, very, very routine scientific assessments, basically. I've only noted the numbers at the science assessment, not the ones on impacts or on technology. So, was it effective? Well, many years ago, this slide was put together and it said if there had not been a protocol, what was the plausible growth in chlorine and bromine entering the stratosphere? And so you could see what the predicted abundance, basically, of chlorine would have been. What was the implication of the Montreal Protocol to make it lower? The London Amendments even lower. Copenhagen and subsequent amendments and adjustments, you see the one in Beijing, even lower. I don't show what the implications for ozone are, but this is the implication for the projections of excess cases of skin cancer over background. So you see it from no protocol to the Montreal Protocol, London and Copenhagen. Clearly, no question that the series of amendments and adjustments to the Montreal Protocol clearly have a major impact. Is there any evidence that it's having an effect? Again, this is an old slide. Several people in the audience have more up-to-date slides than me. But there's no question, through this series of policy changes, one can see effectively the round circles are the observed changes in CFC 12, 11, 113, etc. You can read down the slide quicker than I can say. And then the dotted lines are the projected phase out. Basically today, if you look at what's happening to these chemicals, indeed, all of the long-lived and the medium-lived chemicals are basically following those trajectories. So in other words, the science policy interface in this particular issue, I would argue, has been a real success factor. This, again, is a pretty old slide, but I've just read the latest ozone assessment. Things are not particularly different from this. In other words, we would hope that mid-latitude ozone would recover to its 1980 levels somewhere between about 2030 and 2050, plus or minus a bit, and Antarctic ozone eventually will start to recover. It won't do it for quite a while. So why did we delay between the original Rowland and Molina paper and when action was taken internationally? We had a whole bunch of silly arguments from some people. fluorocarbons are too heavy to reach the stratosphere. Are we really sure that most of the chlorine in the stratosphere come from human sources? Could it be the sun's output? Why is the ozone hole in Antarctica, where most of the CFCs are released in the northern hemisphere? The satellite ozone data doesn't show the same trends as the ground-based data. Are we sure the Antarctic ozone hole isn't caused by natural processes? All of those were things that were delaying tactics by a number of people, predominantly in the industry, but also some skeptics like Fred Singer, who's a skeptic on everything, including climate change. Clearly, however, the evidence lasted, and the evidence is very, very strong. And therefore, when we look at that sequence of events from the Montreal Protocol to the London, Copenhagen and Vienna amendments, they were based on observations and an understanding of the observations, not just the observation, but an understanding of the observations. So the question one could simply argue, did governments and industry demand too much certainty before acting? It's the key question. It's the water under the bridge, basically. But a key question is, how much evidence do you need before you take action? I would argue if it's a serious risk, i.e. elevated levels of skin cancer in their light skin populations, and you're using it for frivolous reasons like aerosol propellants, no risk is worth taking. If it's for a use that has real societal relevance, then I would argue you could wait for much better data. So it's an issue of, did we wait too long, even though eventually we have ended up in a fairly reasonable situation. The climate change, I've already basically said, we have the IPCC. I think it's an incredibly important institution. I believe it has been influential on national and international policy processes. It's led to the convention, led to the Kyoto Protocol and the Paris Agreement. And this is in the face of a significant number of vested interests and climate deniers. And I'll come back to that in a few minutes. This just shows you a very recent slide. And as you can see, even though one started talking about really trying to protect the climate system a long while ago, one can still see huge increases in greenhouse gases. And indeed, since the year 2000, the rate of increase actually is almost twice, not quite, but twice the rate of increase from 1970 to the year 2000. So while governments were accepting the findings of IPCC, basically agreed to things such as the Kyoto Protocol, always seen as a very large increase in greenhouse gas concentrations. Only a few governments really did follow what they said they would do under the Kyoto Protocol and tried to cut back on their CO2 emissions and other greenhouse gases. So things are still not in good shape here. There's no question that if you actually looked at the observation of temperature, both terrestrial and oceanic, and it shows you the global situation on the right-hand side and different regions of the world in the middle here. The black line are the observations, and you can see in literally all cases the temperature trends are going up, especially since about 1960. And in all cases, the blue line, which are climate models with only natural phenomena, do not simulate the observations. The pink line are climate models that have both natural processes included, emissions of that so-called greenhouse gases, changes in land albedo, changes in aerosol concentrations in the atmosphere. And as you can see, both at the global and at the regional level, there's pretty fair agreement between the observations and the climate models, which led the IPCC to say it's unequivocal that human activities are a cause of a large part of the observed changes, not only in temperature, but other changes in precipitation, at sea level, etc. There's been a whole series of studies now about how can we observe any changes due to climate change. Someone's looked at physical systems such as glacier, snow and ice, rivers, looked at biological systems such as our terrestrial ecosystems, and also looked at human-managed systems, i.e. food production. And we are now seeing observed changes that can be attributed to climate change throughout the world. And this, of course, comes from the latest IPCC analysis. One then says, OK, we're already seeing changes. What about the future? On the left-hand side, we have the two extreme climate scenarios from the last IPCC scenario The one in blue is a very low emission scenario. It does lead to probably stabilization of global mean surface temperature around 2 degrees or so. Whereas the high emission scenario, the so-called RCP 8.5, a high emission scenario, as you can see, by 2100 is at least somewhere between 3.5 and 6 degrees Celsius higher than the year 2000. And we've already gone up about 0.7 to 0.8 degrees from pre-industrial to the year 2000, and still going up very high. It's the high emission scenario. And so one looked effectively, would it affect unique and threatened species? Even the 2 degree scenario, the low climate sensitivity, would start to have some severe impact on some species, some biological species. Would it have an effect on the extreme weather? Again, even a 2 degree Celsius change would start to have changes in the frequency and the magnitude of some extreme weather events. Could we see different distributional effects? In some parts of the world, food may be affected negatively, in other parts it may not. Water may be affected in one part of the world. And you can see literally by the time you get up to again about 2 degrees Celsius, you're starting to see a reasonable probability of seeing adverse effects at the distributional level. Global aggregate probably need a bit higher before you can make strong statements, and globally adverse effects on things such as food, but then also potential large-scale singular events. Could there be a reversal of ocean circulation? Could there be a collapse of the West Antarctic ice sheet or the Greenland ice sheet? Could there be a loss of methane from the permafrost? They clearly become more probable the more you increase or the projected increases in temperature. So strong information, strong information to governments that, hey, something's happening here and it's likely to be, on average, adverse in most parts of the world. So if indeed we've now agreed, or the government's agreed, we should definitely limit to 2 degrees Celsius and have a pursue a 1.5, what would it need to be there? Well, to 2 degrees Celsius, you have a 50-50 shot. If we can stabilize the atmospheric concentration of CO2 equivalent, that's not only CO2, but all greenhouse gases, at 400 parts per million, we're already there. If you want to stabilize at 3, you could go have a 50-50 shot at 550, and you can read the rest for yourself. Basically, we've already passed the 400 parts per million CO2 equivalent, and so the chances of stabilizing at 2 degrees Celsius, I personally believe, are very, very small. It would certainly take a rebound effect, basically. So where are we? The key thing is the cumulative emissions of carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. And the models basically show if for a 2 degree target, we've already used up at least half, if not more, of the carrying capacity of the Earth. So we have very, very little leeway to put more CO2 and greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. So we've really got a challenge in front of us. Let me go to the next one. And this just shows you, if you do want to get down to these low... that one I should have showed. So where are we? The black dots of what we've observed, basically, for emissions there. And this is just from fossil fuel. The models are, the red one is, as you can see, it's a baseline with no climate policy at all. The dark blue line would be one that could get you to a cost-effective 2 degrees Celsius with a 66% probability. What we're observing today and the projection based on GDP for the next few years to 2020, we're on the high emission scenario. We are not on the low emission scenario, which is what you would require to get to a 2 degree world. This says almost the same thing, so I'm going to miss it. Fine, okay. So UNEP did an emissions gap analysis. They've actually got an update to this, but I couldn't find it. And what they said is, what have governments promised? And so there's this case 1 to case 4, and they've analyzed, UNEP analyzed all of the national commitments. And what they said is, boy, if every government actually did what they say, you'd basically end up at case 4. And so you would see the emissions basically by 2020 would be about 50 gigatons of CO2 per year. What do you need to be on a pathway to a 2 degree world, which governments have agreed is what we should be on? You'd need to be more like somewhere between about 42, 43 gigs. So there's clearly an emissions gap between what countries have said they'll do, even if they fully implement everything they'll do, case four, and what we need to be on a two-degree world. In fact, the latest analysis by many would argue that if governments do everything they've agreed at the moment, we would see an increase of 2.7 degrees Celsius by 2100. And let's be honest, most of those governments will not do what they've promised. So that says we're on a pathway well above probably 2.7, in my opinion, somewhere between 3 and 4. Now, governments can change their mind and they might put stronger actions in place, but basically the commitments made in Paris will not get us to a 2-degree world. What we need to do is totally transform the energy pathway. We need major improvements in energy efficiency and conservation. In fact, we need to improve by at least 40% by 2030. We need a major change in the amount of renewable energy. Certainly 30% of all electricity needs to be produced from renewables by 2030. We need to also, when we use coal or natural gas, we need to combine it with carbon capture and storage, which says that when you produce electricity from coal or gas, you don't allow the CO2 to be emitted to the atmosphere, but we capture it and sequester it in a depleted oil well, gas well, or a saline aquifer. That technology is not commercially available today, and the world is not doing enough pilots to see if it's economically and technically feasible. And many of these models to get to a 2-degree world, if not nearly all models, assume that biomass with carbon capture and storage will be a dominant source of energy production or a significant source over time, and that would give you negative CO2 emissions. I think people are in cuckoo land if they think we're going to get a very significant amount of biomass with negative emissions when the challenges are for food security, there's some water security issues as well. So major challenges ahead. There is the Paris Agreement, and that is a major step forward. 196 countries have said they will commit themselves to try and help towards a warming of only 2 Celsius. They agreed they should try and pursue 1.5 Celsius. It will take 55 countries representing 55% of global emissions to ratify. Ratification's open for the next year. If, and I've already said this, if all countries fully implemented their so-called intended nationally determined contributions, it would lead to 2.7 if fully implemented. They are promises and aims. There's no legal binding commitments here. And it does depend for most developing countries that $100 billion per year will be provided for mitigation and adaptation. I really would love to see where this $100 billion is coming from. I'm running way behind my time, so I'll shorten the one on biodiversity. But on the climate deniers, satellite data doesn't show the same trends as ground-based data. There was a hiatus, so they claimed, for about a decade in temperature trends at a time of increasing greenhouse gas emissions. That's definitely not the case in the last 2 years, especially with the concurrent El Nino event. The temperature change is due to natural phenomena. The effects of impacts of climate change can be beneficial, and the costs of mitigating are prohibitive and cause major economic problems for individuals and for government. That's the range of where the climate deniers came. Another argument, especially from the US, was why should we do anything if basically China, India, Brazil, Mexico are not going to do anything, basically. US government never did ratify the Kyoto Protocol, largely because of deniers in Congress. But many governments that did ratify it failed to meet their targets by a long, long way. Australia, New Zealand, Canada, nowhere close to the targets. It was basically the power of the vested interest who wanted to maintain the status quo, even when good economic analysis, things such as Stern, it did use a very low discount rate, have to be honest, basically showed that the costs of mitigation are less than the cost of inaction. And also, if you look at the effect of even a loss of 3% of GDP, over 100 years, when you expect GDP to grow between 2 and 5%, it's a trivial economic loss. But governments were still not willing to make those hard commitments to reduce greenhouse gas emissions. Again, how much evidence do they need to act? three major, and I'm not going to go through the details, three major assessments on biodiversity prior to the IPBS. Global biodiversity assessment had no real political traction. Why? It was supply driven by the academic community, and it wasn't an intergovernmental process. The Millennium Ecosystem Assessment, reasonably successful. It was demand driven, but it was still non-governmental, and that I think weakened its power. UK Ecosystem Assessment, which I co-chaired, did two of them actually, very, very influential on the UK government. And there's a number of reasons for that, which if I've got time, I'll touch upon. But fundamentally, we've had some both really good international assessments and basically national assessments. Very simple, a very, very simple conceptual framework for the Millennium Ecosystem. What are the indirect drivers of that change? You know them, they're demographic, economic, socio-political, science and technology and cultural. How did they affect the direct drivers of change? Things such as land use, for example, external inputs into agricultural systems. How did they affect ecosystem services? And how did they affect human well-being? So that was our conceptual framework. We then showed how to link the four types of ecosystem services, provisional, regulating, cultural, into basic security, basic material for good life, health, good social relationships, and freedom of choice and action. So that was the basic framework that we came up with. And again, what did we conclude? Of the 24 ecosystem services we looked at, four increasing, all provisioning services, food such as crops, meat production, etc. Literally all, except climate regulation, and I think that one's iffy, all of the regulating and cultural services were going down. So our message to governments were, of 24 indicators, 15 are negative, 4 are probably about balanced, and 4 or 5 are going up. Now, if you were telling a Treasury minister you've got 24 measures of how your economy is doing and 15 are in terrible shape, you'd get immediate action. What was the reaction to this? Largely nothing, basically. Even though we told the world that really we were losing biodiversity. This shows what was happening to the ecosystems themselves. The light brown is what did we lose by 1950. So you can see, for example, most of the Mediterranean forest had been lost by 1950. The next level of red, light red, was what was lost from 1950 to 1990, where you can see then in the tropical region really started to increase. And in dark red was the projected loss from 1990 to 2050. And as you can see, the projections in the tropical area are really large, such that nearly all of those ecosystems at the top would be lost, 70% would be lost, converted by effectively 2050, a major change. We also looked at species between sort of what I call the fossil record, the recent change, and what do we project by 2050. And again, the projected change is really quite profound, basically. And that's what we're starting to observe of species flora and fauna, major, major changes. You can't read this, I don't expect you to even try, but what the world has come up with is 20 Aichi targets. They're agreed by all parties that are members or have signed the Convention on Biological Diversity, which means nearly every country in the world except one, and that is the USA. And it really is a fairly nice approach to how you can look almost what I call ecosystem by ecosystem. What should the target be on forests? What should it be on coral reefs? What should it be on aquatic ecosystems? So the world has, partially based on the Millennium Ecosystems, has taken on board a real set of targets to try and protect, conserve, and sustainably use and equitably share the benefits of ecosystems. So that's a major step in the right direction. In the UK, we did a similar assessment. And the reason it's been so powerful is it had a scientific advice group and it had a user group. It had a group of 25 people from the private sector, the NGOs, local government, all working as an advisory panel about what information did they need. So we designed it, we co-designed it with all of the end users from the national government to local government, private sector and NGOs. And then they were part of the peer review process and the selection of the experts. It's very similar to the Melanie Miko, except we pulled out the goods. And you'll see why in probably the next but one slide. We looked up, and again, this is again 1,000-page documents, and I'm only going to pick a couple of the key elements of it. So we looked at futures, a green and pleasant land basis, where we really did focus a lot on ecosystem. Nature at work, where we tried to balance the demand for provisioning services like food, clean water, with some of the more cultural services that you would get from our ecosystems, all the way to things like national security and world markets, when world markets says, we don't care about the environment at all, we just want strong economic growth. National security was, we want to be an island unto ourselves, and we want to be self-sufficient in food and fiber, etc. So we ran these plausible futures out, looking at things like environmental awareness, adaptive capability, our ecological footprint overseas, the issues for governance and human well-being. And as you can see, different, if the thing gets to the outside, it's good. And as you can see, nature at work tends to look like, except for, it's actually very good everywhere, because you don't want a big overseas ecological footprint. So based on this qualitative work, it looked like nature at work was way better than any of the others. We then decided we ought to do a really good economic analysis. And so we actually looked very carefully at the services. We had intermediate services where we were not directly dependent on that service for human well-being. We had the final ecosystem service that we would be ultimately, so crops, trees, water supply, climate regulation. We then said, however, what are the goods that we ourselves use, so food, fiber, energy, etc. But to work out what the ecosystem was valued at, you have to say what the apple I buy in the supermarket, there's some ecological value to it, but we also had to put a lot of capital inputs. We had to grow the tree, we had to harvest the tree, we had to transport the apple to the supermarket, etc. So we actually broke down for every one of our ecosystem services to get a final good, what other capital inputs did you have to have, so we could look at the economic value of the service, we could look at the human health implications and the shared social values, basically. So no other assessment has actually done it to this level quite so far. 5 minutes, fine, no problem. So this just so effectively, we use a whole range of economic techniques to come up with, depending on which of the various services that we looked at, basically. Bottom line was, if you look effectively on the right-hand side, where are we today? And in the UK, brown is really bad. Some of our systems are still decaying. 30% still are not in great shape. They're probably declining. And then the rest of them are either getting a little bit better or a lot better. If you look at nature at work, under that scenario, literally all of our ecosystems get better. So does green and pleasant land. But the national security and world markets are really terrible. So if you focus only on provisioning services, you get a really bad result, basically. We then looked on a 1 kilometre by 1 kilometre, how would these all play out, basically, in the UK? And we compared world markets, the extreme, to nature at work. And we looked at the change in agricultural productivity, what would happen to greenhouse gas emissions, what was the recreational value, what was the green space value, and what was the implications on biodiversity. Green is good, red is bad, and except for agricultural output, in economic terms, nature at work is much better on there. But the main thing we also learned is a policy should not be uniform across the UK. The policies really need to be very locally specific. Very hard for a government to do that. But as you can see, none of them are all green or all red. Very location specific. And so once now I've been trying to persuade the UK government to really think about really focused policies that take into account. I'm going to skip quite a bit this just because. So that's how we did valuation in the UK. What we're doing in IPBS is saying that's the wrong way to do valuation. It's too limited. It's the right-hand side. It's the classical view of looking at the economy of nature's benefits to people, looking at market price. We also looked at non-market, so it's better than this. So we looked at market and non-market. We looked at things like GDP and cost-benefit analysis. What we're actually saying in IPBS is, no, we have to have a much more holistic view of the world. We really have to have five values: biophysical, economic, social, cultural, health, and holistic. And we really need to think through how to measure all of those in a fully integrated world where we have social, economic, and environmental considerations. I am going to go back for one slide. This one. And that's our conceptual framework. It brings together two totally different worldviews. In green, you've got, I'll call it the Western view of science. How do you move from drivers to biodiversity and ecosystems, ecosystem goods and services, human well-being? It's what we did in the Millennium Ecosystem. A number of governments and a number of NGOs said, wrong framework. It should really be, what does nature give us? Mother Earth, systems of life, nature's gifts, living in harmony with nature. And so we've brought together two very, very different, diverse worldviews in one conceptual framework, which then means when you do that, you have to have a much more integrated worldview of the diverse conceptualization of value, which then led us to this, which said, fine, we need to look at both the intrinsic value of nature, the nature's benefits to people, which are both biophysical and instrumental, and in that you can see under nature's gifts, regulating provisional and cultural services. And then for a good quality of the relational values, basically, of security and livelihoods, diversity and options, living well in harmony and nature. So when we actually put this value together, we had as many philosophers, people from the humanities, and slightly more than we had economists. So we've actually taken this as our conceptual framework to look at value, to really say, look, the economy is one thing, but it is only one part of the value system. And with that, I'm just going to literally go to the very, very end for the conclusions. And that is simply to say, I think the science policy interface has worked fairly well for stratospheric ozone depletion. In fact, very well. Moderately well for climate. Why? We have strong research programs. We have good international assessment processes. And the issues are global public goods where we have to have concerted international action. Science policy interfaces perform less well for biodiversity and land degradation. Typically, the programs, especially at the international level, are weaker. Until recently, no routine international assessment process. We now have it, best, basically. And you really require local and regional action more than concerted global action. In general, I would argue we need far more social science research on all of these issues. We need many of these international conventions like climate change, CBD, CCD, to start to develop some integrated policies that cut across climate change, biodiversity, land degradation, wetlands issues. We need a much more synthetic approach to international assessment, including web-based approach, so we don't spend half our life traveling around the world. We clearly need far better tools for decision makers, and that's one of the major efforts of IPBS, is to work with decision makers how to interpret and use our findings. We need to strengthen the science base in developing countries, and we need, and I don't know the answers last week, how do we actually decrease the influence of vested interests? Thank you.
What we're going to do in this session of the evening is we're going to start a conversation. I got a list of only about 45 or 50 questions to ask Bob. So we'll start a conversation and we'll get the ball rolling and then open it up to questions and discussions from the audience. So let me start, right? So you've defined at least two of these international processes as successes. Mm-hmm. One of which has clearly had an effect, both in policy terms and an effect on improvement in the actual physical environment, and one for which the jury is still out, to put it, you know, as positively, I think, as you can at this point. So what's the success? How do you articulate what a success actually is in these processes?
The science policy part is a success on ozone and on climate. In other words, I think we've got good structures, the scientific knowledge which includes social science, natural science, economics, etc., technology, engineering. We've got the processes in place to inform governments. And as I said right at the beginning, good policy requires good knowledge, but it's not a sufficient condition. So on the ozone issue, largely because it was an issue that only involved 19 international companies and predominantly all the emissions came from industrialized countries, one could actually work with the policymakers, with industry, to find the solutions. Probably one wasted at least 5 years in not getting the international regulations to where they should have been maybe 5 years earlier, but overall, fairly successful. In the climate issue, I think we've got the structures in place, and therefore from a pure science to policy interface, I think we are informing, both at the national and the international level, governments, NGOs, civil society, and the private sector. The trouble there is the whole issue has been captured by vested interests, basically, which is outside the control of the science process.
So how should the assessment processes deal with that? You have this, you have on the one hand the desire to have a process that's open to experts from all sectors, and on the other hand, you've got some sectors, particularly in the climate debate, but also in agriculture and land use and biodiversity debates with extremely strong vested interests. And yet, how do you structure participation without allowing the vested interests to hijack the process?
I would argue the vested interests have never hijacked any of the assessment processes. I can see no evidence that industry or anyone in any government that is against climate action having hijacked any of the assessment process. Doesn't matter if it's working group 1, 2, or 3 of IPCC. I would argue they're good state-of-the-art assessments and they are not influenced by the vested interest. What the vested interest done, and they've taken those assessments and they've selected particular pieces of information to make their point. So they're focused on the uncertainties in working group 1, the uncertainties in working group 2, and they've managed to focus on the economic implications of 3, and I think distorted the economic debate.
So this brings me at least to this issue of uncertainties. Not all uncertainties are equal in these debates. Some are clearly more important than others from the perspective of the policy interface. They may all be sufficiently interesting scientifically that one might want to understand them better, but they're not all equal from a policy perspective. How could the assessments do a better job at assessing which uncertainties really matter in a decision context?
I would argue, if I take climate then as the issue, I would argue, and I think the scientific community is clearly going in the right direction, trying to get more reliable regional climate projections in order to then to be able to say at the regional level or the more local level, what will the impacts be on food, water, sea level rise, etc. Because I would argue one of the most crucial issues now for most policymakers is to fully understand what are the implications of climate change on things like food, water, energy, human security. So I would argue that's an area of better regional scale projections coupled with better knowledge of how these sectors will respond individually and collectively, given that water, energy, and food are all interrelated. So it isn't looking at one or the other, it's looking at all three together. Clearly on the energy side, I think it would be useful to get more information on the projections of economic costs. But my personal view looking at the numbers is these are not big economic costs, basically. So I would say an area that really could do with more work, it's already going on, is the interface between regional scale projections, impact and adaptation.
All right. Let me open this up now to questions and discussions from the audience. Please wait for the microphone to reach you because we are webcasting and recording this.
Okay. Should I start?
Yeah, go ahead.
Hi, my name is Irene Monasterolo. You just talked about the need for better projections of the economic cost of energy and, I guess, energy transition. So, and you also talked about the need for better tools. So, what should how should better economic and financial models at this regard look like, according to your opinion? Thank you.
I think one question is, do we know enough about the economics for governments to take action? And my argument would be, yes, we know enough about the cost of a transition from a fossil fuel-based economy to a low-carbon economy. The numbers may not be at all exact, but we know the general ballpark of the loss of GDP. And so is it going to be a 2% loss of GDP or a 5% loss of GDP? I would argue, in the scheme of things, whether it's 2% or 5%, we still know enough that we need to make that transition to a low-carbon economy. So do we need to refine that 2 to 5% number for trying to stabilize at 2 to 3 degrees Celsius? I would argue I'm not sure that is the highest priority. Many economists would probably say I'm full of shit, and the answer is it's a very, very uncertain number, and we need to know it better. So I think it's a question of how much evidence do you need, in this case economic evidence, in order to have action. So I would argue I'm not at all worried about having an uncertainty of a factor of 2 or 3 in the economic costs. I think it would still argue to me we need to make that transition to a low-carbon economy.
Bob, Les Kaufman, Pardee Center and Department of Biology. It's obvious that success in the climate arena is going to be a very, very steep climb. Given that, and the way it's captured world attention, which is a wonderful thing, biodiversity is sort of the orphan stepchild. Now, do you think, in the UK example that you gave, it was a wonderful demonstration of how the way those two are inextricably entwined can be conveyed. Do you think it's possible to globalize the benefits of that exercise, or do you think we're basically resigning ourselves to a Permian scale mass extinction?
I agree with your characterization. I would say until recently, the biodiversity issue was a very poor stepchild to the climate issue. Don't think there's any question. I think having the 20 HE targets agreed by the Convention on Biological Diversity in Japan in 2012 was a major step forward to try and at least put biodiversity on maybe not quite a par yet with climate change, but make sure it's visible. I think the key is we need to demonstrate that biodiversity and ecosystems and their services, while it is an ethical and moral issue, and there's an intrinsic value of biodiversity and ecosystems, equally these ecosystem services are incredibly important for social well-being and human well-being generally. And therefore, in the IPBS, when we do our global assessment, we are going to critically analyze, to the degree that data allows us, how important is biodiversity and ecosystems to the poverty goal, to the food goal, to the water goal, all the way through, basically, to the energy goal, implications for gender, etc. So we're hoping that with the IPBS, and with the fact we do have the Aichi targets, that a combination of having now governments recognize they need the Aichi targets, having now we've got an IPBS where we will link biodiversity and ecosystem to the Sustainable Development Goals, and we're going to link it back to climate change and look at the real issues between climate change and biodiversity, hopefully it can elevate the visibility and the importance of it. So, I mean, there's no question. We are going to continue to see major extinctions. There is no question whatsoever. The rate of loss of tropical forests, I think the latest statement from the Brazilian government is, we hope to finally stop our deforestation by 2030. Some number like that. I may not be quite precise. That is a major implication, not only for biodiversity, but also for climate change, because the implications of deforestation in Brazil is a significant source of CO2. Certainly the rates of deforestation or conversion from a natural habitat to a managed habitat in Asia.
mangrove system, grassland system are being radically managed. And so I think there's no question we are still seeing, and we will continue to see, just like we're going to continue to see a certain amount of climate change, we're going to see a continued loss. I mean, I think we're already in a very difficult situation of a major extinction. The question is, to what degree can one limit it? So the problem is, most developing countries need knowledge help, financial help, and technical help. The question is, will the richer countries be willing to work with them to help them on in these issues?
Bas.
Yeah, Bas van Ruiven from NCAR, and I'm currently a semester at the Pardee Center here at BU. You talked also about the process of doing assessments. And I'm actually wondering about what you think of the relationship between the assessments and the scientific community broader. Because if you look back, I sort of observe a more higher specialization, in a way, of people, you know, being able to write and produce good assessments and organize them. And some of the field, if I look to my own field of producing future scenarios for assessments, the field more or less went from a scientific field to a field that's mostly working for assessments at the moment, and the same group of people all the time. And, you know, in one way, it's a change in the science. Another thing is that it's a burden on people. Some people have it in their mandate to do it. And so you see that specialization of a small group of people that are able to do it. Other people, it's not in their mandate, and you lose out of a big part of the scientific community, actually, because they are just not able to contribute, right? And I wonder how you see new tools, new ways to manage this process better so that assessments can actually harvest the knowledge of the broad scientific community.
I think you've put your finger on one area that's a really interesting one. It's very clear, especially on plausible scenarios, which, because I talked too long at the beginning, I didn't show what we were trying to do in IPBS. But I think this whole area of looking at plausible scenarios, I think there's four ways of using scenarios. One is, what are the plausible scenarios? By arguing what's the plausible range of direct and indirect drivers, and what is the plausibility of different end products. That's one way of it. The other one is, you pick, where do I want to be in 2050 or something, and what are the pathways to it, whether it's decarbonization or what. Another one is where you more focus on a single policy and you say, what is that policy likely to be? Or you do it effectively, what was the implication of that policy? Did it meet the policy goals? So, I mean, there's four ways of using scenarios, and I think all four are going to need to be used. What you've put your finger on, however, and I think it's worked relatively well in the climate community. The climate community has been very responsive to doing climate scenarios for IPCC. The trouble we've got, I think we're going to have a big time in biodiversity and ecosystems, is there's no equivalent international community that's been used to working on these issues of plausible scenarios in a more holistic way. And in fact, there was a major workshop only last week, which Paul Ledley went to, who's leading quite a bit of our work for us, a French-American scientist living in Paris, where a whole bunch of people did meet from the biodiversity world and the climate world to do some work on how to put forward a whole bunch of new scenarios that they will use the socioeconomic assumptions out of the climate scenarios, sort of from the RCPs 2.6 to 8.5, but then apply them in some models on biodiversity. I think the challenge, and this is not my area of expertise, is how do you put together models that have both a qualitative and a quantitative nature? And I think the problem when we did the models for the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment is, we changed all of the input parameters between our six worlds, and we mixed up quantitative projections with qualitative projections. And so on the qualitative ones, the output really just mirrored the input by definition. And on the quantitative ones, we changed so many parameters at the beginning, you couldn't follow the bloody causal chain. So I think we have to really think through very carefully how to best do some of these scenarios. As I say, this is not my area of speciality at all, nor is anything these days, to be quite candid. So I think But your point is, how do you bring all of the scientific community on board? Some that actually are funded to actually participate and some which are not. I don't know the answer to that one. We're finding even more simple problems at the moment on it, Bess. And that is, we got money from a trust fund to fund any developing country scientist to participate that is selected based on merit. Anyone selected from the UK, France, even Hungary, their governments pay for them. The US refuses to pay for American scientists to participate in ITBES, even though they do fund the trust fund for developing country scientists to participate. Their argument is the American scientists can just take it out of their grants. Yeah, quite. I mean, it's ridiculous, which means we are missing out on some of the very, very best US scientists and Canadian scientists and Australian scientists in ITBES at the moment until we find a solution to this. So we've got multiple problems of getting the best people actually involved. Equally, one wants to run new scenarios. Where is the money to run these new scenarios? And so that's another issue that we're going to have to put some effort into.
In front.
Great. Scott Vaughan from IST. Bob, how many more IPCC reports do you think are needed? And do you think that the current model of the interim, whether there are different hybrid models that I know that are under discussion and they come up every time the five-year report is released, and do you think we need to keep doing this model, or do you have thoughts on what it might revolve to?
Yeah, I haven't really, to be honest, given much thought to how IPCC should do it. All I know is I'm not convinced we need 1,000, 2,000 pages of working group 1, 2, and 3. If you were to ask me what would I do, I would say for each of the three working groups, what were the 20 most important findings that came out of the fifth assessment report? And it, maybe it's 30 key findings, but something like 20 or 30. These are the key findings. I would then say, what is the knowledge between the fifth assessment report and the sixth assessment report? Has it strengthened that finding? Has it weakened that finding? Or has it even changed that finding? And really write a 100-page report, no more than a 100-page report that really focuses for each of those key findings, 5 to 10 pages maximum each, on whether that finding has been strengthened, weakened, or changed, and just really focus on. Now, there can be some new things that come to light. So, for example, in the second assessment report of IPCC, we didn't talk about ocean acidification. So if a new big issue comes up, you obviously have to bring that into, say, a sixth assessment report. But I really do believe we could make these. The question is, are we writing them for only the policymakers, are also the academic community? They do have basically two uses, basically. But I actually really strongly would argue, why don't they sort of just really cut back to more like 100-page reports? What we've done on the IPBS is we actually started with starting a series of regional reports with sub-regional specificity. So four region, all of the Americas, but at least six sub-regions within the Americas, all of Africa, six sub-regions in Africa, all of Asia and the Pacific sub-regions, and then Eastern and Western Europe together, we broke that into three regions. So we actually started with regional reports, which will much of it will feed into the global report that's at least a year later, basically. The global report will also it will synthesize what we've learned from the regional reports, recognizing, you know, the quality of the data varies from one region to another. The quality of some of the modeling varies, and we'll take that into account. But there are some issues you can only look at globally, not regionally. So it will synthesize what we've learned from the regional reports, and it will bring in the value added of taking a global perspective. I would argue on IPCC, that's how I would do impact and adaptation. I would actually start with regional assessments and learn from those and build up and synthesize and lay on top of that what could you do globally. Even on the one of working group 3 on energy, I would say that could be broken into two parts. What's the status of technology development that's pretty sort of global. But how do you, what are the opportunities and barriers to penetration of technologies into the market? That's very national and regional. And so I would even argue Working Group 3 should give serious consideration to look at some of the national and regional dimensions of the barriers and the opportunities. So that's the sort of thing I would find a way of maybe shorting them much more, make them much more policy relevant. What are the 10, 20, 30 issues in Working Group 1 and Working Group 2 and Working Group, and then do a true synthetic report. Because I would argue the closest we ever came was IPCC number 3, which is the one I chaired. But that's because it wasn't because of any leadership issue there. It was simply the government's actually allowed an attempt at synthesis with 9 synthetic questions, but they weren't all very synthetic in hindsight. But by the time they did the IPCC 4 and 5, the synthesis report largely became a bit more a summary and a précis of the 3 SPMs, largely because the governments didn't allow for a truly synthetic report. And I think that's something that they really need to have, is a truly synthetic report across the 3 working groups. But, I mean, it's an essential. Should they keep doing assessments? Yes. We need to keep these issues in front of governments. If you didn't have IPCC, you'd have to create it. Exactly how it does the reports, I think there's a question mark.
Got one in the back here. Adil?
Thanks. Bob Adil Najam from the Pardee School of Global Studies. Thank you very much for coming. I had the honor of being associated with IPCC 2, 3, and 4 and working with you. It's great to have you here. I have a very different sort of question, though the question is the same as the first one that Tony asked you. In the last few months, something just struck me. Maurice Strong died. The 1972 conference, Earth Summit. Then Jim McNeil died, author of the WCED, the World Commission on Environment and Development. And then a few weeks ago, Mustafa Tolba died, former UNEP head and at least associated with the beginning of the IPCC. And it suddenly struck me that there's a generation of people who had set the current process of these institutions and this ambition in place who are literally falling off, and there's a whole bunch of others. And I wondered what they were thinking looking back of all the work that they and others had done. And I suspect they weren't very happy that after spending a lifetime, we are talking about adaptation, which is really a failure of mitigation. Which is why we talk about it. So I wanted you to maybe reflect of your years in this and at least comment on my sense that we now have far more number of people doing this, but far more of the work is just busy work to keep the processes going, as opposed to that sort of, not activist, but that ambition-driven effort of a particular generation that most of my students now don't even know about. Thoughts?
Okay. I think there's clearly challenges. I mean, I think most of the issues where we need information, we need disciplinary excellence embedded within multi and transdisciplinary research endeavors. I mean, none of these issues are purely natural sciences, social sciences, humanities, engineering, etc., etc. So the question is, how does one stimulate inter-multi-transdisciplinary research when still, I mean, the center Tony's at, and there's centers in Harvard I know, etc., are really important to try and stimulate people working across boundaries. But there's still challenges, even in many universities, of working across different departments. Secondly, the funding, in most cases, certainly in the US and the UK that I know, is still largely disciplinary specific. And thirdly, most journals are still largely disciplinary specific. So there is still a challenge of doing inter-multidisciplinary research. But I think we're moving in the right direction. And I think international programs like Future Earth, which have still got to prove themselves. Now we've folded up things like IGBP, Diversitas, IHDP. If they don't make a success at Future Earth, we will have gone backwards. So we're now on the edge of a potential good way of proceeding in transdisciplinary research, but they're going to have to really come through in the near term. I'm not sure we're doing busy work. I mean, I think the science that's being done in universities, government labs, etc., NGOs, on climate change is essential to inform decisions, whether in governments or the private sector. I think the work being done on biodiversity equally, and there's some incredible challenges there. Our knowledge really, I mean, let's be honest, our knowledge of understanding the relationship between biodiversity itself and the services that we get from different ecosystems is pretty rudimentary. We make some heroic leaps of faith between the biodiversity and the functionality of biodiversity and effectively the services. Once you get to the services, the economics, I'm convinced, is one of the easier parts. It's not perfect. The other values, the non-economic values, very tough, as that when one looks at some of these relational values, etc., very, very tough. So a lot of work's been done there. I think if Tolbert looked back, Tolbert would say stratospheric ozone depletion was a major success, and I, Tolbert, will take a lot of the credit. And I have no problem with that view. He really was quite instrumental of pushing the system, basically. Climate change, he would be extremely disillusioned. And I think many of us would be quite disillusioned of the political process. I do think the science policy part is working about as well as we can make it work. But the political process of vested interest is really, we've wasted the last 10 years. 15 years, really wasted it. So any carrying capacity for more greenhouse gases is really small now. So a 2-degree target 15 years ago was clearly potentially achievable. It's not even obvious to me that it's technically achievable anymore. You know, all the models tell me I'm wrong, that it's still technically achievable, but probably only just. Is it politically achievable? I doubt it, basically. But the other point is, I think these global assessments are fine. But unless you do national assessments, there's no true ownership at the national level. The UK national ecosystem, as I said, I had a scientific committee overseeing it, and it really was a nice balance between social and natural sciences, even some reasonable representation from humanity, so a range of social science, had an end-user group, and it was reasonably well-funded, And with a firewall between me and the ministers, but I then reported directly back to ministers with a firewall. In other words, I had no influence on it. And therefore, I could talk to ministers, and that's what led to actually now having a natural capital committee reporting to the Chancellor of Exchequer, and the first time they've ever had a new environmental policy in 20 years on the environment. So, but it meant that only a national assessment could do that. And most countries aren't. We spent, and it was cheap because, again, we didn't pay the scientists any money to do it. And the travel costs, when you're only in the UK, are trivial compared to a global set. But it cost us about $5 million to do two assessments. Most other countries have come to, how do we do it for 500K? You can't do it for 500K. It's just not possible.
So, Bob, I don't want to keep people from the reception, which will start in just a few minutes. But I've got one more thought that I'd like you to talk about. You've talked several times, pointed out several times in your presentation about the process of doing assessments and the importance of trust, the importance of participation. And it strikes me that we've got sort of two kinds of capacity building to do. This whole scientific assessment process and its interface with public policy, for many of us, it's really a fairly recent phenomenon. Now, Adil may disagree. We have a whole generation of students who have never lived in a world where we were not debating climate policy, right? But on the other hand, all these processes date from the middle 1980s, and you know, it's in a sense as though we've moved out of this sort of age of individual heroes into this institutionalization of the relationship between good science, environmental science, and how it speaks to policy, how it informs policy. It's also largely a phenomenon that's been driven, for the most part, sort of created and driven by those of us in the industrialized North. Mm-hmm. So what kind of training, what kind of capacity building would you suggest we do both for a more complete engagement of developing countries, but also for this sort of next generation of scientists and policymakers to become more comfortable and actually use this interface in a more constructive way.
There's not a problem anymore of getting developing country experts to participate because there's always funding. So in the IPBS, for example, 70% of the scientists will come from developing countries and only 30% from industrialized countries. The challenge there is the scientific infrastructure is just not very good. So the scientific knowledge base is not very good. So it's the knowledge base that has to be improved. Just participating in the assessments themselves is capacity building for many experts from developing countries and Eastern Europe, to be quite honest. I don't know if there's much training except what is an assessment? What are the features of an assessment that are different from doing a review? What it means, however, is trying to learn a wide range of languages. In other words, the language of the philosopher is very different from the language of a natural scientist. It's very different. There's a big difference in language, but even between an ecological economist and a macroeconomist. So being participating in these assessments, it's being able to have a conversation outside your own speciality, and therefore learning enough about the other specialities that you can at least have a conversation, basically. Now, you made a point that the processes still emanate from the 1980s, and they do, when the ozone assessments were put together, IPCC. I wrote a couple of papers on how to actually transform this into a totally different, a purely web-based approach. And I really do believe we should give some real thought to how to do a web-based assessment process. There would still be some face-to-face meetings, but the majority of it would be done through a setup through a web-based system. And we might try and pilot something along this as part of the IPBS, because we've spent most of the money and time is going to meetings. And it's a waste of money, and it's a waste of people's time. When I say a waste, it's a large cost in time and a large cost in money. So if we can actually rethink how to use web-based systems to do some of this, I think it would, and how to make it more, say, policy relevant. Do we need these 1,000-page reports or not? And the answer may still be yes, but we should ask the question. One of the things that we've done on the first two assessments for IPBS is make sure the policy, the SPMs are no more than 15 pages. Really make sure they're still a readable length, because some of them are starting to get longer and longer and more complex. So, right. So some training is needed, but I'm not sure whether it's a huge amount, basically.
All right. Okay. So with that, I'd like to invite everybody to adjourn outside here, where we have a reception for a little while. And thank Bob for coming and sharing his thoughts.